Jesus said, I am the resurrection, I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this in Christ both died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. We brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our sister, Felicia Everdeen, for burial. She was washed in holy baptism and anointed with Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember before you this day our sister Felicia. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are united with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
the hymn Angel Voices Ever Singing. Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Felicia Everdeen, and we pray that having opened to her the gates of larger life, you will receive her more and more into your joyful service, that of all who have served you in the past, she may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lays and reigns of you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Kindly be seated for the first scripture lesson, which will be read by Janisa Griffith.
A reading from the Word of God, written in Wisdom chapter 3, verses 1 to 5 and verse 9. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good. because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord.
You will now have a tribute by Mrs. Raquel O'Neill.
I read this tribute from Mrs. Edlyn Innes on behalf of the former Ministry of Tourism and Sports. I first met Mrs. Felicia Everdeen Goodridge in February 1985, when the Ministry of Tourism and the Environment was conceptualized under Minister Aaron Truss and Permanent Secretary Miss Lolita Applewhite. Mrs. Goodridge was the executive officer with a staff complement of about 30 persons and was tasked with making the ministry fully functional. Mrs. G, as we called her, was a no-nonsense person. However, she was very endearing and was a mother figure to all, both senior and junior officers. She encouraged persons to give of their best with regard to the work assignments and in their personal deportment. Mrs. G was the life of the ministry, and she made things happen, even when it meant borrowing utensils from her Aunt Camilla to save face whenever there was an important meeting at the office. She was almost always the spokesperson, whether at a staff function or saying farewell to an officer, since we all knew that she would represent the office well, and all persons could relate to her statement, "It would be remiss of me," in those speeches. She had the gift of public speaking, deportment, and could always find the right phrase, whether from the Bible or literary works, for any situation. She was unapologetically of the old school and believed in showing respect to one and all. She was a kind and giving person, and despite having to raise her 5 children almost single-handedly since her husband passed away early in the marriage, she never hesitated to give willingly, be it in time or in kind. We also knew of her devotion to her parents, siblings, and the church family at St. Lucie's Parish Church. She never worried about finances, because she lived by the mantra that God will provide, and that if you do good, good will attend you. I can truly speak for all those persons who worked with her between 1985 and 1998. Less than a year ago, we reunited at the funeral of one of our dear colleagues, Keith Innes, and we never thought that we would be paying tribute to her so soon. We will cherish her memory forever, and she will be thoroughly missed. I pray that one day we will all meet again. Rest in peace, my friend.
Psalm 84. We'll now have the reading of the second scripture lesson, which will be read by Mr. Darren Goodrich.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the seventh chapter of Revelation to John, beginning at the ninth verse. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne, and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, and singing, "Amen. Blessed and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We will now have the reading of the eulogy, which will be read by Mrs. Lisa Griffith and Master Caden Goodrich.
Good morning to all. I begin with an Irish blessing, and it goes, "Mothers hold their children's hands for a little while, but they are in their hearts forever." Felicia Everdeen Dowding was born on July 20, 1938. She was the last of four children born to the late Evans and Ianthe Dowding, her siblings being Edlin and Emerald, who predeceased her, and Marlene. Mummy was educated at the St. Swithin's Primary and Modern High Schools. She worked as a teacher at the primary level, an insurance agent, and an accountant in the Barbados Civil Service. She retired from the post of executive officer in the former Ministry of Tourism and Sports in 1998. Mummy was married to the late Everton Goodrich, and that union produced a wonderful son, Don, and four beautiful daughters, Raquel, Lisa, Lana, and Kay. She was the adoring grandmother of 10, three boys and seven girls. At the relatively young age of 43 years, Mummy became a widow and was faced with the daunting task of raising five children, ages ranging from 6 to 18 years, on her own. However, she was surrounded and supported by her loving parents, sisters Edlin and Marlene, and a group of close friends who helped to make this task easier. During her life, Mummy would have touched the lives of many. At work, she was a trusted colleague and mentor to the younger members of staff. In her personal life, she was a devoted family member and true friend. Mummy would often do without as long as others around her were happy and contented. Her generosity was not only extended to her immediate family and friends, but to all with whom she came into contact. She had a soft spot for children. When friends met overseas for extended periods, their children moved in with us. In my profession as a teacher, Every vacation, I brought home children from the school to spend time at our home. They would quickly become her grandchildren, and there was no discrimination. They too would receive the same love, attention, and discipline which she gave to her own grandchildren, and were given the assurance that they would be welcome in her home at any time. However, persons quickly learned not to mistake her kindness and friendship to be used as avenues to be taken advantage of. Mommy had a quick wit and a very sharp tongue. She never minced words. If she didn't like something, you certainly knew it. Never want to hold a grudge, she would say what she had to say. And after expressing herself, she would assist you if there was need.
Granny was a faithful and active member of this parish church. She served on the parochial church council, functioning first as secretary and then treasurer for many years. When she retired, more of her time was dedicated to the work of the church, sitting on various committees and helping to plan many of the events. She had a fantastic memory, and if information was needed on anything church-related at St. Lucie's, Granny was there to give valuable input.
Anyone who knew Mommy well knew that she loved Shakespeare, classical music, and gardening. She loved to entertain, and on numerous occasions, friends and families would be invited to lunch or supper, much to the dismay, as the house had to be spotless before the guests arrived. Everyone would enjoy the delicious meals prepared and served by Mommy. Mommy was a strict disciplinarian. Never one to spare the rod and spoil the child, my siblings and I often experienced that rod of correction, one of us more often than others. That person whom we call the reoccurring decimal was always in line for punishment. But to save that sibling any embarrassment, that person shall remain nameless. Mommy's methods of punishment vary to get her messages across. While reminiscing earlier, a certain incident came up. One Saturday, three of us got up early and completed our chores because we wanted to attend a certain event being held later that night, or so we thought. Later in the evening, we dressed and got into the car. Before the driver could reverse, Mommy came up and asked where we thought we were going. She politely informed us that we would be staying at home. I could not believe my ears. I told the others to ignore and let's go. But by the time I looked around, the three musketeers had now become one, as the others had disappeared into the house. I was livid, but not wishing to suffer the consequences alone, I too returned to my room. Mommy had won that round. On another occasion, these same three sisters decided that we would attend a 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. cruise a Saturday night as well. We got dressed, but this time Mommy said nothing, and we left home feeling vindicated. Of course, we were young adults and could make our own decisions. We had run this wrong, or so we thought. Boy, were we in for a surprise. We enjoyed ourselves immensely. And on return home, in the wee hours of the morning, Mommy opened the door, smiled sweetly, and inquired if we had enjoyed ourselves, to which we replied in the affirmative. We crawled into bed tired but happy. What seemed like moments later, Mommy knocked on our bedroom doors and reminded us that church was at 8 o'clock. Was Mommy for real? We were exhausted. We decided that we would not be attending that church that morning, but we were in for a rude awakening, literally. She made it quite clear that if we were adult enough to party until morning, we were adult enough to get a nap and be bright-eyed and bushy-tailed to attend church 2 hours later. Sure enough, at 8 a.m., we were sitting in church, eyelids drooping. But each time each one of us nodded off, we felt a probe in the back to keep us awake. We had won a small battle, but Mommy had won the war. That message was clearly received. Mother was in charge.
Granny's strong belief in discipline was also extended to her grandchildren. Summer, Christmas, and Easter vacations were full of spells, but mostly trails at Granny's house. She insisted that we display good manners, but respectful to all and not to follow the multitude to do evil. She hated noise, confusion, and most of all, disobedience. When we fought, Granny often gave us the opportunity to solve our spat. If we couldn't resolve our differences, then she would step in. She spoke to us once, maybe twice, but if that instruction was given a third time, rest assured, it was accompanied with a hard smack. Sometimes we would get angry and grumble behind her back when we were punished, but deep inside, we know she did it to help us keep on the right track. Really though, she was a doting and adorable grandmother, ensuring that she cooked our favorite meals and remembered our birthdays, which were always accompanied by the gifts we all eagerly anticipated. Just as with her children, she made sure that we attended church and Sunday school every week, as there was no compromise.
Right.
When it came to our Christian upbringing, as far as school was concerned, she insisted that we study hard and complete all assignments on time, always reminding us that a good education was the key to success. She was just as proud of her grandchildren as she was of her children. She helped us through our disappointments and celebrated our achievements. I knew that she was eagerly awaiting the results of my secondary school's entrance examination. Sadly, that was not to be, as she passed before the results were released. I, however, believe that she would have been pleased to know that I will be attending the Alexandra Secondary School later this month. We will endeavor to keep her memory alive by maintaining her high standards and become the well-rounded citizens she would have wanted us to be.
Dear Mommy, we are eternally grateful to you for your guidance and love throughout the years. Growing up, we were not always happy with your strict upbringing. Yes, we grumbled, complained, and referred to you as a till of the hand or the iron lady behind your back, of course. But as we grew older, we recognized the reasons behind such actions and certainly appreciated your efforts, as they have shaped us to be the responsible citizens that we are.
Granny, Sunday, August 29th, 2021, was one of the saddest days of our lives. We never imagined life without you so soon, but we all take comfort in the fact that you are now with Jesus, free from all the pain and suffering that you endured during the final days of your life. As we say goodbye, Auntie Lisa and I leave with the words of the following poems. Grandma, there was a magic in Granny's touch and sunshine in her smile. There was love in everything to make our lives worthwhile. Your life was full of loving deeds, forever thoughtful of our special needs. Today and tomorrow, our whole lives through, we will always love and cherish you.
A mother just like you, we just want to let you know you meant the world to us. Only a heart as dear as yours would give without a fuss. The many things that you have done, all the times that you were there, helped us to know deep down inside how much you really cared. Even though we did not say, we appreciate all that you went through. Richly blessed is how we felt having a mother just like you. On behalf of the family, Caden and I take this opportunity to thank all those who would have touched Mommy's life in a special way as she would have touched yours. A special thank you to Caribbean Home Help, particularly Miss Jamie Bess, Mommy's caregiver, who made sure that she was as comfortable as possible during her final weeks. Finally, sincere gratitude is extended to all for your expressions of condolence, love, and support to us during this extremely difficult time. We understand that because of the COVID-19 protocols, you cannot be here physically, but knowing that you care, indeed, is a great source of comfort.
Rest in peace, dear Granny, until we meet again.
The hymn for all the saints who from their labors rest. Oh. This morning I speak in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me first, on behalf of the Goodridge and Dowden family, welcome all who are present to this service of thanksgiving, and also those who are watching and listening virtually. I want to acknowledge the presence of the Reverend John Griffith, and Reverend Trevor O'Neill, Rector of St. Philip's Parish Church and Rural Dean of the Christ Church Deanery, who are Felicia's sons-in-law. And also to welcome her cousin, Reverend Mylon Springer. I want also to acknowledge the presence of our representative, the Honorable Peter Philip, Minister in the Ministry of Housing and Lands. His Excellency, the Reverend Charles Morris, Deputy Commissioner to London, as well as the Reverend Corris Brooker, who's now based in Grenada, have asked to extend condolences to the children and other relatives and friends of Felicia. Part of the 29th verse of the second chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, and part of the 29th verse. Words spoken by old Simeon. A man, St. Luke says, was righteous and devout. A man who was looking for the consolation of Israel. Simeon, my friends, was a man of God. A man filled with the Holy Spirit. For the gospel writer says that the Holy Spirit was upon him. Oh, Simeon had the Holy Spirit anointing. And this man had heard so much about the coming Messiah. He had heard so much about Jesus, who was coming to set his people free and to save them from their sins. One who would deliver not only Israel, but the whole world from sin. And hearing so much about Jesus, Simeon's one desire was to see Jesus, the Messiah, the chosen one of God, before departing this world. Simeon's only desire was to get a glimpse of the one referred to as the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the fierce of 10,000s. Scripture tells us that God made it known to Simeon. Yes, that God promised old Simeon that he would allow him to see Jesus, the Messiah. St. Luke, the evangelist, says that it had been revealed to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, and verse 26. The Lord granted Simeon his heart's desire. For on the day of the presentation, when Joseph and Mary entered the temple, carrying with them the Christ child, now 40 days old, to present him to the Lord as the Jewish custom stipulated. Old Simeon was right there in the temple. St. Luke says that inspired by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, Simeon took the child up in his arms and blessed the Lord. It's in Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, verses 27 and 28. Oh, what a joy it was for Simeon to see Jesus, the Messiah, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords. Oh, how delighted the old Simeon was to see and to experience the presence of Jesus Christ, the one he had longed to see. His heart, no doubt, was brimming over with joy and excitement. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you this morning, if you do not know, that there's joy in knowing Jesus Christ. There is excitement in experiencing the presence of the Lord in one's life. Oh, my friends, there's joy in serving the Lord. One songwriter describing that feeling puts it this way: floods of joy, oh my soul, like the sea billows roll since Jesus came into my heart. Simeon was beaming with joy and excitement. Oh yes, with joy and excitement, he reached out for the child, took Jesus in his arms, and praising God in the words of the text this morning, said, "Lord, I am now ready to go. Let your servant depart in peace, according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation." People of God, we have come here this morning to this holy sanctuary of God, not to mourn the loss, but to give God praise and thanks and to celebrate the life of Felicia Goodrich, née Dowding, one who experienced the salvation of the Lord, one who knew the Lord, one who experienced the presence of Almighty God and His Son Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit in her life. One who was filled with joy in knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. Like Simeon, she was devoted to her God. Like Simeon, Felicia never ceased to praise her God. And she never ceased to praise her God because she knew that the Lord had done great and wonderful, indeed marvelous things for her. Oh, what a joy it was for her in serving the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, my brothers and sisters, I believe, and I strongly believe, that our sister Felicia has departed this life in peace. I believe that like Simeon, she was ready to depart this world and be at home with her Lord. I believe that she was prepared. For at some time she did say that to me, that she was ready to go. And I wish to say to you that her preparation to meet her God was not a last minute thing. For from a child, her mother, Ianthe, like Eunice, the mother of Timothy, exposed her to the Lord Jesus Christ as well as to the things of Almighty God. Like Timothy, she possessed a sincere faith. From a child, she experienced the presence of God in her life. She experienced the goodness of the Lord. Brought up first in St. Swithin's Church. And if that was not enough, she also went to Avistown Church of God. She loved church. And here at St. Lucy's Parish Church, from a child, Felicia was in the house of the Lord, and she never strayed. She never looked back. Her family was a religious family, a family devoted to the Lord. And Felicia followed in the footsteps of her mother, Ianthe, in ensuring that her children were brought up in the fear and nurture of the Lord. She was not one to come to the house of God and leave her children at home. They were always in church. They had to be in church with her. Many a night, they were here in this church straight from school in their school uniform. You know that, huh? Yeah. She strongly believed in the words of the wise man Solomon. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. Thank God, her children have not departed from the things of God. They are still in the church of God today. You know, whenever there was a service here, whether it be in the morning or the evening, on a Sunday or a day in the week, if there was one family sure to be present, sunshine, rainfall, it was the Dowding Goodrich family. All of them, including the children. That was the extent of their love and commitment to God and His church. Yes, all the children had to be here. You know, I believe there was one who was mouthy, and that person shall remain nameless, who I know used to grumble. But that one had to be here with the others. They loved the Lord, and they loved His church. And not only were they in church, but they were all involved in the life of the church. The activities of the church. Felicia had an abiding love for the Lord and for His church. She served in all most every aspect of the church. Sunday school teacher, member of the parochial church council for 18 years, secretary of the church council, treasurer of the church council, member of the fundraising committee, outreach committee, you name it. And Felicia was there to serve. You know, the only role in the church she did not play was that of the priest. And believe you me, if she could, she would have played that role as well. She knew about church and how church should function. And because of her knowledge of the church, I was able to benefit from her. For there were times when I sought her wise counsel. When I needed to know something, I called her. And she was ready and willing to help me. For indeed, Felicia was of tremendous help to the priests of this church, especially the Reverend Donald George and me. And you know, whatever Felicia did in the Church of God, she gave of her best. Not doing it for any recognition or reward, save that of knowing that she was doing the will of God. She was one who did not stand for mediocrity. If things had to be done, they had to be done well. They had to be top class, or as the old people say, first class. For she would always say, we have to show others that St. Lucy is not behind God's back, but that St. Lucy people can do things and do things well. You know, she was very, very good at planning events. And she had a way of seeing and coming up with things that no one else will think of. She would always call and say, I think we should do this, or we should do that. And I believe that was a God-given talent. And also as a result of her work in the Ministry of Tourism, having to prepare for major functions and conferences. The last major event Felicia was involved in at this church was in the dedication and opening of the William Donald George Parish Center. And as young people will say, that was the bomb. Thanks to Felicia Goodrich. She was a great asset to this church, as mentioned earlier. Always ready and willing to assist in its work. You know, we exist to make a difference in this world. Felicia did just that. She touched the lives of many people in a gentle way. But now, her life work on earth has ended. I shall miss her. We here at St. Lucy shall miss her. We are saddened at her death. But I believe that earth's loss is heaven's gain. For she is in a better place. The word of God in the first lesson this morning reminds us that the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. She has gone to a place where she will no longer be wearing a mask, but wearing a crown of righteousness. A place where she will no longer have to social distance, but will stand with myriads and myriads of saints before the throne of Almighty God. She has gone to a place where the saints of God shall not be limited to 25, but will be numberless as the sand on the seashore and the stars in the sky. Felicia has gone to be among that number. Then the saints, oh yes, the redeemed of the Lord, go marching through the New Jerusalem, washed in the blood of the Lamb. She has gone with the sign of faith. And so I say to you, Dawn, take heart. Your mom has fought the good fight. Sherry, take heart. Your mom has finished the race. Lisa, take heart. Your mom has kept the faith. Lana, take heart. Your mom has gone to receive her crown of righteousness, which the Lord will award to her on that day. Kay, take heart. Your mom has gone to receive her new body, a spiritual body, a body like that of Jesus Christ. Dominique, Brandon, Dawn Marie, Traquan, Janisa, Renee, Daniel, Christina, Darren, Caden, be of good courage. Your grandmother has gone to be with the Lord in that mansion Jesus is preparing for her. Marlene, be of good courage, for your sister has gone to receive her new name, her name written down in glory. Felicia has departed in peace. We thank God for her contribution not only to this church, but to this nation. Yes, indeed, we give God thanks for her life, work, and witness. And we pray that she may rest in peace. To her children, her grandchildren, sister Marlene, and other relatives and friends, on behalf of my family and the church family here at St. Lucie's Parish Church, I extend sincere condolences. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, that light perpetual shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen. Let us now stand and reaffirm our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the words of the Apostles' Creed as found on page 5 in your leaflet. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We shall now have the praise of intercession. This should be led by Reverend John Griffith.
For our sister Felicia, let us pray to Lord Christ, who said, "I am resurrection and I am life." Your response after each prayer will be, "Hear us, Lord." Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Felicia, and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister Felicia to eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in sorrow at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Felicia, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death, and be occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. Amen.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Their sorrow and pain are no more.
Neither sighing, but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind. And we are mortal, form of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created us, saying, "You are dust, and to dust you shall return." All of us go down to the dust. Yet even at the grave, we make our song, "Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia."
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Their sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Our Father.
Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Let us commend our sister Felicia to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Felicia, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Felicia. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
Rest eternal, grant unto her, O Lord,
that light perpetual shine upon her.
May her soul rest in peace.
Amen. The hymn, Pleasant Are Thy Courts Above. Nunc Dimittis.
I don't have an audio kit.
Right. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart therefore is glad and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy hear our prayer, forgive us our sins, and at our last hour let us not fall away from you. In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister, Felicia Everdeen. And we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved son shall come again in judgment, both this, our sister, Felicia Everdeen, and we ourselves, may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and of whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity. We give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who having finished your course in faith now find rest and refreshment. May we, if all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to her, O Lord. May she and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious unto her. The Lord lift up his countenance upon her and give her peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. And unto him that is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Too tall.
To him, O Jesus, I have promised.
I'm not afraid of the dark.
Father loved the Savior. What a soldier he had been. But his steps will be more steady when the saints go marching in. We'll be right back.
than so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. In his beauty, the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guards every footstep and gives me a song.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servant Felicia Everdeen, being raised with him, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God, forever and ever. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord.
Let light perpetual shine upon her.
May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. Thank you all very much and do have a good day.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you.